Acts chapter 7. We're really not going to be skipping over any of Acts. We're just going to be covering a lot of it today. You know, it never dawned on me just how much Stephen's death takes up in the book of Acts. You know, I started thinking about it. We're introduced to Stephen in chapter 6 as they start talking about the deacons of the early church. It says that Stephen was a man that was filled with the Holy Spirit and with power, and he became one of the deacons. And then you get into chapter 6, and you go from chapter 6 all the way through chapter 7 talking about Stephen. I find it really fascinating. Of all the deaths recorded for us in the Scriptures, of all the people that die, there is only one person who covers more pages. Their death covers more pages than Stephen, and that's the person of Jesus Christ himself. Almost two chapters surround the stoning of Stephen. You know, I started thinking about that. I have to be honest with you. Of all the sermons that I've preached, this one impacted me more than anything else that I've preached in a long, long time, because it raised a question for me. How do I want to be remembered? Think about it. We remember Stephen because of his death. We remember Stephen because he was stoned. If I were to ask you how Stephen died, almost everybody in the room would say, well, he was stoned to death. They threw rocks at him. They killed him because of his faith in Jesus Christ. We understand that about Stephen, but it raises a question. If we remember him at his death, what'll be remembered about me at mine? I started thinking about people. Richard Nixon will forever be remembered for Watergate. Mother Teresa will always be remembered for her compassion shown to those that are impoverished. Al Capone will be remembered as public enemy number one for his notoriety. I started thinking, what am I going to be remembered for? Will I be remembered when my kids were in high school, I was Jordan and Ashley's dad? That would be the way I'd be remembered. Now that I'm married to Betsy, there are certain circles we associate in, and everybody remembers. They know me because I'm Betsy's husband. How will I be remembered? Will I be remembered as the guy that built a church building? I'm thinking, hey, that's not exactly what I want to be remembered for. I'll be honest. I know a lot of things I don't want to be remembered for. Will I be remembered because of my mistakes, because of my sins, because of my most embarrassing moments? You see, I don't think God wastes any words when it comes to Scripture. I think that everything in there about Stephen's life is to call our attention to the fact that all of us, death is a universal. He died, and we remember him in his death. But what do we remember about him? I got to tell you, there's a lot more to him than just his death. We're going to look at that today and think about how we want to be remembered. Here was a man who went out in style. Repeat this after me. When I go, I want to go out in style. I think that's pretty good. I want to go out in style. In Acts chapter 7, verses 59 and 60. Listen, we don't have time to read all two chapters. You're going to have to do some reading on your own. But I want us to go back and I want us to look at those moments. You see, an obituary, how many of you have ever read an obituary? An obituary can capture the facts of a person's life, but they can't really tell you the essence. What most of us focus on when it comes to Stephen is his obituary. He died. We find his death in verses 59 and 60. Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Listen as I read from God's Word. Listen to what it says. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then he knelt down and he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. What a great way to go, huh? Praying to the Lord, worshiping God, asking God to touch your life, and then the last words, forgive him. Then he lays down and goes to sleep. What a great way to go. Here is a man that went out in style. And I think about my life. When I go, will I go out in style? When people look back at my life, what will they remember? What am I passing on to my kids? What am I passing on to this congregation? There's going to be 600 people in church again this morning, and I'm trying to deal with the fact that, you know what? I'm either going to enrich your life or I'm going to waste our time. What will I be remembered as? Here's a bigger question. How will you be remembered? What will people remember you for? I started thinking about this, and I started realizing, you know what? If I'm going to go, I want to go out in style. I want to be remembered like Stephen. I want us to go back and begin in chapter 6, beginning in verse 5. And we're going to pick out some things about the way he's remembered in these two chapters. And I want to apply them to our life. Because if nothing else, this calls our attention to the fact that we need to live our life in a way that when we're remembered, we're not ashamed. I want people to remember me well. Listen to what it says in chapter 6, verse 5. And the saying pleased the multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. Go down to verse 8. And Stephen, a man full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. That's the way I want to be remembered. I want to be remembered, number one in your outline, as a man of faith. I want to be remembered as a man who had a real relationship with Jesus Christ. Twice in chapter 6, Stephen is pointed out as being that kind of guy. There was something so real about him, something so genuine about him, that people said, here is a man of faith. Here is a man that has the power of God abiding on his life. Here is a man that knows Jesus in a personal way. Listen, I may never be recognized as being the most muscular preacher in the world. I may never be set apart as being the best-looking pastor in the world. I'm not too sure why on that one, but I probably won't be picked for that. Dave's over here going, because he will. He's going to win. But I can be remembered as being a man of faith. I can be remembered as being a man of faith. And you can be remembered as a man or a woman of faith. Now, I've got to tell you something. Just because you're a person of faith doesn't mean that life is going to be easy. Stephen was about to be stoned to death for his faith. But still, we remember him, not just because he died. We go back a little bit and we discover, here he is pointed out as being a man of faith. Here is a guy that really had something going on with his relationship with Jesus Christ. Listen, when I breathe my last, when I'm dead and gone, I hope that people say, that guy believed what he said. That guy was a man who followed Jesus. See, if I'm going to die, I want to die as a follower of Jesus Christ. That's the way I want to be remembered. Going out in style, I want to be remembered as one who is a person of faith. Second thing, I want to be remembered as a person who kept my cool. If you start reading the story about Stephen, what you discover is that they brought him in and started accusing him of all kinds of things. They said, this man blasphemes. He says he's going to tear down the temple. They brought him before into a trial. And this is what it says about him. It says, when the council looked at him, they looked at his face and it was the face of an angel. Let me ask you something. Do you always keep your cool? Do you want to be remembered? I don't know about you, but when people attack me, I get defensive. Anybody else get defensive? When people start hitting on me, you know what I want to do? I want to do this. Just about that quick. See, I don't want to be the guy that gets mad at the drop of my hat. Listen to what it says. Number two in your outline. A person that kept my cool. And they also set up false witnesses who said, this man does not cease to speak blasphemous words against the temple, or this holy place and the law. And all who sat in the council, they looked steadfastly at him. They saw his face as the face of an angel. How much calmer can you be? How much more serenity do you need? I don't want to be this guy that gets mad about everything. Listen to me. Let me ask you a question. If you were to ask people about your life, would they say that you get angry at the drop of a hat? That it just takes little things to make you mad? Listen, the size of the things that make you mad are a good indication of where you are in your relationship with God. If it just takes little things, then it may mean that you have a very little relationship with Him. Listen, people that are always whining, people that are always complaining, people that are always griping, if your attitude is always negative, you're always mad about everything. I've learned something in life. I'm 55 years of age, and I've learned this. Not everything is worth bleeding over. We don't need to fight battles over every little thing. We don't need to get mad at every little thing that happens. We don't need to get angry. We need to be people when we die, when we're dead and gone, that keep our cool. What does it take? Did you guys watch the playoff games last week? Did you see the kicker that missed the field goal? He's going to be remembered for that. He is. But I got to tell you, the reports that I heard later in the week about people calling him up and making death threats, they're going to be remembered for that. Now, let me tell you something. The old saying is, it doesn't matter whether you win or lose, it's how you... Let me correct that. What you need to do is remember that it is a game. I don't care how you play it. Win or lose, it's really not how you play the game. It's remembering that it's a game. I want to be one of those guys that I don't want to kill somebody over a missed field goal. How many of you think that's a little silly for somebody to get that angry about something like that? Let me ask you a different question. What silly things have you got angry about? What foolish things, what small things, what unimportant things push our buttons and get us mad? I don't want to be remembered that way. I want to be like Stephen. I want to be remembered as a man who keeps my cool. I want to be remembered as that guy who keeps his cool. Last week I told you, I'll tell you again, look at your neighbor and tell him, calm down, take a chill pill. Tell him right now. If I'm going out, I want to go out in style. If I'm going out, I want to be a person of faith, and I want to be a person that keeps my cool. Third thing, I want to be a person that gets my culture. This is really important for the church today. We have got to awaken and see what Stephen does. From chapter 7, verse 2 to chapter 7, verse 50, he does a rehearsal of the history of Israel. He talks about its history. He talks about its past. He talks about everything under the sun in giving his defense. And then he gets down to these verses in verses 51 and 52. He says, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit, just as your fathers did so to you." This is what he said. He said, this is a generational thing. We're missing something here as a people. There's something in our culture that says we want to reject the ways of God. Stephen is remembered because he understood what was going on around him. He understood that people weren't going to like the gospel of Jesus Christ because people hadn't liked what God had to say before then. And they're certainly not going to like it now. I want to be remembered as a pastor who understood my culture. I don't know if you've picked up on this, but in the first 150 years in the history of this country, it was safe to say that Christianity had home field advantage. But something happened about 75 years ago. And all of a sudden, what we discover is that when it comes to the marketplace of ideas, Christianity is just one idea among many. It may be the truth. That's what I believe it is. I believe that Christianity is the way and the truth and the life. But I got to tell you, the world out there sees a whole lot of choices that they can make. There are a lot of other ideas that they can embrace. How many of you know at the library here in Odessa you can go and buy books? Did you know that? They have a used book rack. I went in there since I've been here. I bought books. This is from Unity Village. That's another idea about Christianity. Not Christian, but another idea. Here's an interesting book that I bought off the shelf there. This is in a town of 5,000 people. It says, "Anyone can go to heaven, just be good." This is a primer on Buddhism. Bought it off the rack in the library here in Odessa. Somebody had it and read it. Here's another one. This is in Odessa. Bought it off the library. This is called The Sons of Shiva. And it's a comic book on Hinduism. Bought it here in Odessa. Let me tell you, there has been a cultural shift in our society. We live in a world, and I've discovered this, lost people don't want to go someplace and be bored. Let me rephrase that. Nobody wants to go someplace and be bored, not even Christians. They have better things to do with their time on Sunday morning than to come here and let me waste it. People say, why do you try to interject humor in your sermons? Because people are not interested in the uninteresting. You want to get something out of this, don't you? How many of you would like to get something out of this today? Because if you don't, you're not coming back. You're going to go someplace else. You can stay home and watch TV or something. The change and the shift has been so subtle, though. Did you know that? How many of you have noticed the shift in our culture? It's dramatic. Let me give you one example. Anybody know who Carl Sagan is? Carl Sagan is a scientist on PBS and did the book Cosmos, or Cosmos, however how you want to pronounce it. I found this really interesting. The cosmos, this is a direct quote, is all that there is, or ever was, or ever will be. Isn't that interesting? This man is an agnostic, not a Christian, agnostic. Now let me show you how subtle the influence is. Anybody heard of the Berenstain Bears? This is the Berenstain Bears' Guide to Nature. You want me to read the whole thing to you? Now maybe I shouldn't do that. Let me just get to the main point here. What is nature? What is nature? Nature is every person, everything, and place here on earth and out in space. Nature's the sun, the moon, the stars, its faraway planets, its mountains and valleys, it's the shore, it's the sea. Nature is you, nature is me. Listen to it. It's all that is or was or ever will be. Does that sound familiar? It's all that is and was or ever will be. Carl Sagan wrote, the agnostic wrote, the cosmos is all that is or was or ever will be. The Berenstain Bears, nature is all that is or was or ever will be. Let me tell you, there's a lot of competing ideas out there. Stephen understood his culture. He knew that they were a people that were hard-hearted. They had their ears all stopped up. They weren't interested in hearing the truth. I thought about that and I said, sounds familiar. We are surrounded by people that are stiff-necked, hard-hearted. They have their ears stopped up. They don't want to hear the truth. There's been a shift in our culture. If sermons aren't relevant, if sermons don't mean something, if this sermon today doesn't somehow speak to you and where you're at in your life, or maybe where you want to be when your life comes to an end, then some of us are in the wrong place. Me. See, the reality is I want to be remembered as someone who understood how to touch the culture I found myself in. How to touch people coming out of that culture that has so many options and so many choices and so many other things that they can be doing on Sunday. People say, why in the world do you sing so many different songs? Why do you sing these songs with the guitars and the drums? Why don't we just go back to the good old religion, those old hymns? Let me tell you something. If we do the old hymns, nobody's going to come but old people. And old people already know Jesus, but young people need to come to know Him. We have to change our methods without changing the message. I'm sorry. But that's just the way it has to be. Things change. This church is not what it was 10 years ago. And it's never going to be what it was 10 years ago. It can only be what God is calling us to be today. And for us to be real and for us to be alive, we have to be relevant to the culture we find ourselves in. Listen to me. This church competes not only with the other churches in Odessa, but with the Kansas City Chiefs and the Kansas City Royals and everything that goes on in the city. We're in a deep competition because in the marketplace of ideas, Christianity is just one idea in a big marketplace. And so we have to be people that understand our culture. Some people still get upset because the preacher doesn't wear a three-piece suit. Let me tell you, I want people to feel like that they can come to church here wearing the best that they have, even if they don't have a three-piece suit. Why? Because I want to understand my culture to impact my culture. Not to be like it, not to compromise with it, but to do something about it. Here was Stephen. He said, this is the history, and this is what's going on. It is a cultural thing. Our culture rejects God. And that's why you reject God. How do you want to be remembered? I want to be remembered as one who understands and gets my culture. Number four, fourth thing, and I love this one. I want to be a person that Jesus defends. I love this one. Listen to these verses. They take him in and they get upset when he says that and they start stoning him. They start trying to put him to death. And this is what Stephen says. And when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. That is the place of advocacy, the right hand of God. That's the place of advocacy. And he said, look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Get the picture. You got to get this in your mind. While he was being attacked and assaulted on the earth, Jesus was standing before the Heavenly Father. And this is what he's saying. He is mine. That's good stuff. When I'm dead and gone, I want to have confidence that Jesus is pleading my case. You can see all the sin in me that you want. You can see my mistakes. You may remember me for all those things, but my Jesus is going to remember that I'm His. He's my advocate. He's my defender. You know, when our church started growing, the rumors started circulating. Oh, you can't, that Baptist church is taking over. They're endorsing candidates from the pulpit. Oh, my goodness. Listen, let me tell you something. You know, if you've ever been here, that that's not true. None of that's true. But I got to tell you, the world can believe what they want to. My Jesus defends us. He knows what's true. He knows what the truth is. See, I want to be a people. People will talk. They will make wild claims. That's what they were doing here to Stephen. And yet he saw Jesus in his right place. Listen, when I'm dead and gone, I want people to look at me laying in that casket and go, say this, Jesus was on his side. What a great testimony. What a great way to be remembered. Let me ask you something. Are you on his side? See, that's the most important question. I want people to look at me and go, he was on his side. He was on his side. Number five, fifth thing. I want to be, number five, a person that forgives. The last thing that comes out of his mouth, Father, don't hold this sin to their account. What a great man. Then he knelt down and he cried with a loud voice, Lord, don't charge them with this sin. And when he said this, he fell asleep. His dying words were about forgiveness. His dying words, think about it. His dying words were about forgiving the people that were killing him. Are you still mad at anybody? Still angry about someone that hurt you in the past? Maybe we need to develop a spirit of forgiveness about us. You know, I talked to one of the funeral directors this week because I'd always been told that when somebody dies, it's really, really hard to change the shape of their mouth. That your mouths, they tend to follow the pattern of your life. Now, I know that means that for some people like me, they're going to have to wire mine shut because it moves so much, you know. And there may be others, Leslie. I don't know. I'm not saying. You can talk to Tim about that later, okay? But you can't change that natural shape. That if a person smiles throughout their life, that it's much easier to put the corners of the mouth up. And if not, they're just kind of a blank expression. I found that really interesting. And I started thinking and applying this to Stephen's life. See, I want to go out with a smile. I want to go out in style. So I'm going to smile a lot. So it's easy to do this with my face. I'm going to need all the help I can get when I get there, see? But I want to be that kind of person that's like Stephen. I want to be forgiving of others. I don't want to write people off just because they disagree with me. I don't want to write people off because they cross me. I've been hurt just like everybody else. I want to be one that can say, Father, forgive them. What a great example. Jesus gave that example, and then he turns around and Stephen comes up and he gives that same example. If I'm going to go, I want to go in style. I want to be remembered as one who had a forgiving spirit about me. I want to forgive others. That's what he did. Can you imagine being able to do that when they're throwing rocks at you? What a great legacy to be one of forgiveness. Listen, I got to tell you, I'm reading through this and preparing this message, and I'm thinking, what legacy did I leave for my kids? What have I taught them all these years? It's scary. Listen to me, parents. Let me tell you something. Your kids are watching you. Jordan's preaching down at Clinton, and just outside of Clinton, down at Calhoun, and I went down and listened to him preach, and it's like looking in a mirror. You talk about scary. I didn't know the kid watched me and listened to me so much. When they're teenagers, you don't think they hear anything, and now all of a sudden, he's me. Some of you have been there, and you know what I'm talking about. It's scary. It's scary. See, I want to be that forgiving person that leaves the right kind of legacy for my kids. Lastly, number six, let's wrap it up. I want to be a person that inspires. You got to get into chapter 8. Chapter 8 starts out and persecution breaks out against them. Saul was there consenting to Stephen's death, and persecution breaks out against the church, and they were all scattered everywhere. We come to these words, verses 4 and 5. Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word, and Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them. What an inspiration. I got to tell you something. Telling people to come and follow Jesus and you can get stoned is not a real drawing card. I mean, you're going to die. If you come and follow Jesus, they're going to throw rocks at you and you're going to die. That is not a real positive thing to invite people to come to. And yet something happened that inspired them. Because as the church was scattered because of the persecution, everywhere they went, they proclaimed Jesus Christ. Who are you inspiring? I want to be remembered as that person that inspired people to be better than they are. To rise up and to live the standard that God has set. I don't want to inspire people to follow my bad steps, my negative outlook, my negative attitude. I want them to follow the positive things. But I got to tell you, people are watching you and people will follow you. We look at this passage of Scripture and what we discover about Stephen is that all we had in the stoning was his obituary, and now we're beginning to discover everything that took place, the essence of who he was. And what we discover about him is he was a man that inspired. He was a man that really inspired. You know, the true measure of my success as a pastor is what will you do when I'm gone? What will this church do when I'm dead? The true measure of my success as a parent will be seen in what my kids do when I'm dead, when I'm out of the picture. But you know what's true about me is true about you. The true measure of your success as a parent, the true measure of your success as a Sunday school teacher, as a deacon, the true measure of your success in any avenue, any field, is what will people do when you're gone? What kind of legacy do you leave? What kind of roadmap are you leaving behind? Oh man, we've gotten it so wrong. I know guys that they get so invested in their work, they become the top salesman in their company and they lose their family in the process. What kind of legacy is that? Let me ask you some good questions. Think about these. You want to go out in style? You ask yourself this question. What excites you? What captures your attention? What are you willing to pour your life into? That's a really good question. Because you see, the things that excite us, those are the things that we'll be remembered for. See, I love what I do. I would give up everything. I'm not going to say this too loud, but I'd almost do what I do on Sunday morning for nothing. I said almost. I said almost. Why? Because it excites me to do what I do. What excites you? That's the things that we're remembered for. What frustrates you? If it takes little things to frustrate you and anger you, then you're missing something somewhere. I want my life to be lived so that it takes a really major event before I get out of hand. I want to live my life in such a way that the things that upset me have to be massive. Good question. What upsets you? Good question. What amuses you? Do you realize how serious a problem we have in our society today with the issue of pornography because of the internet? What do you spend your free time doing? Now we have access to movies on our television sets that 25, 30 years ago you had to go to a back alley someplace in Kansas City to see. What are the things that amuse us today? Men beating each other up? You remember the Roman Empire had gladiators, and they fought to the death. It makes you wonder, what kind of legacy will we leave? What kind of person am I going to be remembered as? The things that excite me, the things that upset me, the things that amuse me, those are the things that I'll be remembered for. And you know what? I don't want to be remembered for some of those things. What are the things that shape you? What books do you read that influence your lives? What people do you associate with that influence who you are? Those are the things that shape us. You see, here's the thing. Everybody in this room, you're going to leave your mark on this world. Every one of us. The question is, will it be a question mark? Or an exclamation point? Or a period? What will it be? You see, I want to be remembered. Let me boil it down as a follower of Jesus Christ. I want to be remembered that way. Now listen, I hope I don't leave for a long time, but when I go, I want to go out in style. I want to go out like Stephen. I want to go out as a man of God. I want to go out as one who was a person of faith, who kept his cool, who understood his culture, who was defended by Jesus, one that forgives others, and one that inspires people to greatness. I want to be that kind of person. I want to be a follower of Jesus. So the question becomes, how? How can I be a follower of Jesus Christ? Three things. Number one, I must accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior and Lord. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. The very first step for me, the very first step for you, is to accept what Jesus Christ did on the cross as sufficient for our salvation, as the only way of salvation. You see, the truth is that God has a standard, and that standard is perfection. And I have to be honest with you, I am anything but perfect. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's an imperfection. That's not living up to the standard. Any sin, no matter how big or how small, that is enough to mar it if the standard is perfection. None of us fit the standard. But one did, and his name was Jesus. And he took the punishment that I deserved and that you deserved when he died on the cross. And I must accept what he did as sufficient for my salvation. I'm forgiven. You may see all my flaws, but my defender says he is forgiven. Second thing, I want to commit myself to follow him. I'm going to make a choice. I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to follow him with my life. I'm going to live my life in a way that really makes this piece of paper come to pass. I want to try to be better at being a person of faith, at keeping my cool when under pressure, of understanding my culture and being a witness before them, not just following along with them. I want to be one that knows and is confident that Jesus forgives him. I want to be that man that can forgive others. That's what being committed to him looks like. And then lastly, I'm going to trust him to transform me. Because I got to tell you, I can't do it on my own. Because if it's up to me, I'm going to get mad over little things. If it's up to me, I'm going to get frustrated and I'm going to be unforgiving. If it's up to me, I'm going to want to hit back when somebody hits me. Here's the good news. Once I've accepted Him, once I've committed to follow Him, it's not up to me. It's up to Him to change me. From the inside out, attitudes and actions, desires and wants, He can transform my life and He can transform yours. Today, I want you to know, when I go, I want to go out in style. I want to be a man like Stephen, a man of faith, fully committed, fully following Jesus Christ. What about you? How will you be remembered? What about you? How do you want to be remembered? Let's bow together. Father, thank you for the truth of your word. I pray, Heavenly Father, that the boldness of the message today has found good soil, because it's a message that we need to contemplate and struggle with and listen to. Because all of us in this room are headed down the same road. Death reaches out to every man, woman, and child from the point of birth. It's my prayer today, Heavenly Father, that we would make a brand new commitment to you. That we would think about our own life and how we'll be remembered. That we'll think about the legacy that we're leaving.